जैन।
आज की इस चर्चा में आप सभी का हार्दिक स्वागत है। और ये भी आप सभी जानते हैं कि ये इस वक्त बिल्कुल एक बर्निंग इशू है हमारे समाज का, हमारे देश का, राष्ट्र का। और इसके बहुत सारे पक्ष हैं जिनके बारे में हमारी जानकारी होनी चाहिए। तो सामान्य रूप से जब हम सेमिनार करते हैं तो उसके दो ही पक्ष होते हैं। एक होता है कि आप क्या जानते हैं और दूसरा होता है क्या मानते हैं। सेमिनार से बाहर जब हम औपचारिक रूप से या अनौपचारिक रूप से एक दूसरे से बातें करते हैं तो आप सभी ये जानते हैं कि वो एक बहस में बातें चली जाती हैं, और वो सिर्फ इसलिए चली जाती हैं क्योंकि आप मानते हैं। जानते कितना है इसके ऊपर आपका कभी जोर नहीं होता, और ना उसको कभी हम ज्यादा जानने का प्रयास करते हैं कि हमें और कितना जानना चाहिए ताकि हम संवाद कर सकें और विवाद से हम बच सकें। इन सारी बातों को ध्यान में रखते हुए मैं आज का ये चर्चा एक अलग सी बात से आरंभ करना चाहता हूँ, क्योंकि मुझे भी कई बार कई लोगों से बातचीत करने का मौका मिला और कोशिश ये थी कि भी किसी भी तरह के विवाद में ना पड़ा जाए, बात को समझा जाए। और जैसे कि मैंने अभी आपसे कहा है कि ये सेमिनार जानने के लिए ज़्यादा है, आप मानते क्या हैं वो मेरे लिए ज़्यादा कंसर्न का नहीं है। ठीक है कि उसको हम ओपिनियंस में ज़रूर ले लेंगे कि आप मानते क्या क्या हैं, उसको हम बाद में लेंगे। मैं जिस बात से आरंभ करना चाहता हूँ वो ये है कि क्योंकि चर्चाओं के दौरान ये भी मुझे सुनने को आया कि मैं क्योंकि किसान नहीं हूँ, प्रोफेशनली भी और वैसे भी, लेकिन मेरा तर्क ये था कि मैं किसान से अलग भी कहाँ हूँ। जिस प्रोफेशन और जिस परंपरा, मेरे पास दोनों ही चीज़ें हैं, दोनों से ही मैं बिलोंग करता हूँ। तो जिस परंपरा और जिस प्रोफेशन से मैं बिलोंग करता हूँ उसमें मैंने कभी अपने आप को किसान से अलग नहीं समझा। संस्कृत को मैंने कभी किसान से अलग नहीं समझा। और उसका तर्क ये था कि बुद्धि के हल से चेतना की धरती पर हम भी ज्ञान की खेती करते हैं। केवल सिर्फ आप हल चलाएं उसी को किसान कहेंगे तो वो मुझे लगता है किसान को बहुत सीमित कर देना होगा। किसान कोई इंडिविजुअल नहीं होता, किसान के साथ जुड़ा हुआ सारा समाज होता है जो उसको सपोर्ट करता है, और फिर किसान उस उनको उनका फल देता है। ये एक को रिलेशनशिप मैंने अपनी परंपरा से देखा, सुना और समझा है। तो मैं यही बात आप लोगों के साथ साझा करना चाहता हूँ कि मैं क्या जानता हूँ। उस जानने को और अधिक विकसित करने के लिए आज हमने ये चर्चा रखी है, और उसके लिए हमने आमंत्रित किया है प्रोफेसर लखविंदर सिंह गिल जी को, जो हेड हैं डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स पंजाबी यूनिवर्सिटी पटियाला में। और उनसे हम आगे भी कई बार निवेदन करते रहे हैं और उन्होंने हमारी हमेशा रिक्वेस्ट को स्वीकार किया है। और बहुत सारे ऐसे टॉपिक्स जैसे कि वेलबींग इकोनॉमिक्स और इस तरह की अन्य कई विषय थे जिनके ऊपर उनके विचार, उनकी बातचीत, उनका स्पष्टीकरण हमें सुनने को भी मिला, और उसमें स्पष्टता भी हमें उस विषय के बारे में भी आई। देखने को लग सकता है कि संस्कृत और इकोनॉमिक्स डिपार्टमेंट मिलके जो कर रहे हैं उसका क्या लाभ है। लाभ केवल यही होता है कि हमारे ज्ञान का, हमारे देखने का, हमारी परसेप्शन का विस्तार हो। वो केवल विस्तार ही ना हो, उसमें एक गहराई भी आए, हमें इश्यूज को समझने की क्षमता भी विकसित हो, उसको गहरे से भी और उसको व्यापक रूप से भी। तो इसी दृष्टि से आज की ये चर्चाएं हैं, और इसीलिए इसके ये तीन पक्ष रखे गए हैं कि किसान बिलों के फैक्ट्स क्या हैं, ये तो कम से कम हमें स्पष्ट हो। पढ़ के जरूर पता लग जाता है, लेकिन फिर भी वही कि हमारा पढ़ा हुआ और एक एक्सपर्ट स्कॉलर का पढ़ा हुआ वो एक अलग बात बन जाती है। और फिर उसको लेकर के जो एप्रिहेंशंस हैं हमारे समाज में हमारे किसानों की, वो क्या है, और ओपिनियंस जो हमें आम लोगों की समझ से लेकर के पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज तक, इंक्लूडिंग जो स्पेशलिस्ट हैं इस फील्ड के, उनकी अपनी अपनी क्या ओपिनियंस हैं, उन पे हम चर्चा भी करेंगे और समझने की कोशिश भी करेंगे। मैं समय ज्यादा ना लेते हुए कुछ एक सवाल आप लोगों के साथ साझे करूंगा, और उससे पूर्व ये आप सामने स्क्रीन के ऊपर देख सकते हैं कि तीन जो बिल हैं उनके नाम हैं, और नाम ही इतने लंबे हैं कि सामान्य रूप से या आम आदमी को तो इन नामों का भी पूरा पता नहीं होगा। अगर सर्वे किया जाए तो मुझे लगता है कि बड़ी कठिनाई सभी के लिए उत्पन्न हो जाएगी कि ये बिलों के नाम क्या हैं। तो मैं बिलों का नाम ना पढ़ते हुए केवल आप लोगों के साथ वो चीजें शेयर करूंगा जो आवश्यक हैं आप, और ये मैं मानता हूं कि आप लोगों के पास काफी जानकारियां वैसे ही इकट्ठी होंगी, पहले ही होंगी, तो उनको हम और देख लेते हैं। जब संस्कृत विभाग ने और इकोनॉमिक्स विभाग ने जब ये निश्चय किया कि इसके ऊपर हमें चर्चा करनी चाहिए और समझने का प्रयास करना चाहिए, तो निश्चित रूप से कोई भी चीज अपने आप में ही पूरी नहीं होती, उसके पीछे एक पूरा कॉन्टेक्स्ट होता है, उसके कुछ बेसिस होते हैं, कुछ डाटा होता है, उसकी हिस्ट्री होती है। अगर हम ये सोचें कि हिस्ट्री का कोई मतलब नहीं होता, तो ऐसा नहीं है, पूरा का पूरा एक इतिहास होता है जो उस वस्तु को परिभाषित करता है, और फिर उसकी इंटेंशंस क्या हैं। तो मेरा निवेदन यही रहेगा आज के मुख्य वक्ता से, डॉक्टर साहब से, कि इन बातों को ध्यान में रखते हुए जो हमारे सामने इन सब बातों को रखेंगे कि किसानों का इस देश में जो इकोनॉमिक्स के पर्सपेक्टिव से इतिहास रहा है, क्योंकि जब 1947 में हमने नई इकोनॉमी को चुना, मार्केट इकोनॉमी को जब चुन लिया, तो फिर उसके बाद हमारे पास क्या ऑप्शंस रह जाते हैं। दूसरा जो सवाल है कि व्हाट आर द फैक्ट्स, जो डाटा बेस्ड होते हैं, प्लानिंग बेस्ड होते हैं, वो कौन से हैं जिसके आधार पर ये किसान बिल बनाए गए, और अब उन्हीं फैक्ट्स और डाटा के बेस पे उनका विरोध भी हो रहा है। व्हाट आर द इम्प्रिहेंशंस रिगार्डिंग लैंड, मंडी सिस्टम, किसान प्रॉफिट, होर्डिंग, प्राइस राइज, ये भी हमें जानना है। और फिर उसके साथ ही हमें ये भी जानना है कि व्हाट आर द ओपिनियंस ऑफ पॉलिसी मेकर्स, किसान, पब्लिक, पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज, कॉरपोरेट, ETC रिगार्डिंग दीज बिल्स। ये बात मैं इसलिए दोहरा रहा हूँ क्योंकि अक्सर हम ओपिनियंस में आकर के लड़ने झगड़ने बैठ जाते हैं और बात बीच में से रह जाती है, और उसमें एक दोष जो बहुत बड़ा रहता है कि हम दूसरे की बात को सुनना भी नहीं चाहते। अपनी हमारे अपनी सोच, हमारी अपनी जो परसेप्शंस हैं वो इतनी हावी हमारे पे हो जाती हैं कि हम दूसरे की बात को न सुन पाते हैं न समझ पाते हैं। इसके साथ कुछ और सवाल मैं जो चाहता हूँ, जो मेरे हमेशा रहे हैं और लार्जर परस्पेक्टिव में वो क्वेश्चंस रहे हैं। पहला सवाल तो उसमें जो मैं जानना जरूर चाहूंगा कि व्हाट मेक्स वन थिंक दैट पीएम मोदी सो हार्ड हेड दैट ही विल गो अगेंस्ट द फार्मर्स इंटरेस्ट्स। निश्चित रूप से कि पीएम मोदी में इतनी कौन सी जो है वो बुद्धि और ऐसी आई है कि वो फार्मर्स के इंटरेस्ट को हनन करके और इस तरह के वो बिल लेकर के आएंगे। सबसे पहला प्रश्न तो यही सामने आता है, लेकिन बाकी जो दो सवाल हैं वो इकोनॉमिस्ट से मेरे रहे हैं और पहले भी रहते रहे हैं। When India was an agrarian country, then why economists chose market economy over agrarian economy, and then what outcome was expected from the market forces? आज जो हम हालात देख रहे हैं वो मार्केट फोर्सेस ही पैदा करके लाई हैं, उसमें कोई भी क्या कर सकता है कि जब आपने सारे लगामें जो हैं इंडस्ट्री को दे दी, कॉरपोरेट सेक्टर को दे दी, और वही जब सब चीजें टिकेट कर रही हैं, तो हमारे पास एग्रेरियन कल्चर को, एग्रेरियन इकोनॉमी को रीएस्टेब्लिश करने के लिए हमारे पास क्या ऑप्शंस बचते हैं या क्या फ्यूचर में संभावनाएं हैं। और तीसरा एक सवाल जो मैं और मुझे जो डिस्टर्ब करता है वो है, इज इट नॉट द फैक्ट दैट द ग्रुप ऑफ इकोनॉमिस्ट प्रपोज दीज बिल्स बेस्ड ऑन सम डाटा एंड अदर द सेकेंड ग्रुप द अदर ग्रुप of these economists oppose the same conclusions. निश्चित रूप से गवर्नमेंट के पास अपने इकोनॉमिस्ट का ग्रुप होगा, उनके एडवाइजर्स होंगे, हैं, जब आप उसके ऊपर नेट पे देखते हैं तो पूरे बहुत क्वालिफाइड लोग उनके एडवाइजर्स हैं, वो एक तरह का डाटा इकट्ठा करके जो है वो गवर्नमेंट को दे रहे हैं और उसके बेसिस पे वो बिल बनाते जा रहे हैं, और दूसरी तरफ अब जो अपोज किया जा रहा है वो दूसरी तरह के इकोनॉमिस्ट हैं जो उन सारी चीजों को अपोज कर रहे हैं कि नहीं नहीं ये डाटा है जिसके आधार पर ये इसका विरोध किया जाना चाहिए। तो कुल मिलाकर के एक हम जैसे लोगों के लिए एक बड़ी मुश्किल सी स्थिति पैदा हो जाती है कि हम अपना पक्ष कैसे निर्धारित करें या समझें कैसे, पक्ष निर्धारित करने से भी पहले समझें कैसे कि इतने सारे ऑप्शंस हमारे सामने आ जाते हैं। और ये जो आप फोटोग्राफ देख रहे हैं कि एक तरफ तो आप कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ मार्केट इकोनॉमी है और दूसरी तरफ एक सेंसिबल इकोनॉमिक्स को आप लाना चाहते हैं, एग्रीरियन इकोनॉमिक्स को, उन दोनों का इक्वालिटी कैसे आएगी, कैसे आप रोकेंगे कि वो हावी ना हो मार्केट इकोनॉमी, चाहे कितने ही चेक्स एंड बैलेंसेस आप उसके ऊपर लगा लें, कैसे ये संभव होगा। तो इन सारे प्रश्नों को हम आज की चर्चा में देखेंगे। और इसके साथ ही मैं आज के मुख्य वक्ता जो स्कॉलर भी हैं और साथ ही साथ हैंडसम हैं उनसे आपका परिचय कराना चाहूँगा। और जैसे कि मैंने पहले भी आपको कहा है कि उनसे मैं अक्सर दिशा निर्देश लेता रहा हूँ जब वेलफेयर इकोनॉमिक्स और ग्रॉस नेशनल हैप्पीनेस इंडेक्स आदि के ऊपर चर्चाएं, और बहुत खूबसूरत उनके विश्लेषण रहे हैं और निश्चित रूप से मैं हृदय से उनका सम्मान भी करता हूँ और हमेशा उनको सुनने के लिए लालायित भी रहता हूँ। तो मैं मौका नहीं छोड़ता कि मैं सीधे उनसे बात करूं, और बिना औपचारिकता से हमेशा मैंने उनसे बात की है और ये उनकी कृपा है कि वो हमेशा मेरे निवेदन कार्य करते रहे हैं। तो संक्षेप में मैं उनका परिचय आपसे कराना चाहूंगा कि वो प्रोफेसर ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स एंड हेड हैं डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी पटियाला, साथ ही साथ वो कोऑर्डिनेटर हैं सेंटर फॉर डेवलपमेंट इकोनॉमिक्स एंड इनोवेशन स्टडीज पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी में, साथ ही साथ वो डायरेक्टर भी हैं इंटरनेशनल स्टूडेंट्स के यूनिवर्सिटी में, बहुत बड़ी जिम्मेदारियां निभा रहे हैं। और उसी के साथ साथ उनके जितने अवार्ड्स हैं, जितनी अचीवमेंट्स हैं, क्योंकि हम सभी लोग अचीवमेंट से लोगों को जानते हैं, उपलब्धियों से उनको जानते हैं, ये एक पक्ष होता है। तो उनको एशिया फेलो प्रोग्राम में एशिया फेलो का अवार्ड मिला है, इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंटरनेशनल भी उन्होंने किया है, और यूजीसी रिसर्च फेलोशिप एमफिल पीएचडी आदि के लिए उनको मिली है, और उसके अलावा स्टेट मेरिट स्कॉलरशिप, नेशनल मेरिट स्कॉलरशिप आदि भी उनकी उपलब्धियों में है। और साथ ही साथ उनकी विजिटिंग पोजीशंस को अगर आप देखें तो रिसर्च फेलो के तौर पे उन्होंने सियोल नेशनल यूनिवर्सिटी कोरिया में और फोर्ड फाउंडेशन डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स येल यूनिवर्सिटी आदि भी विजिट की है। साथ ही साथ ऑनरेरी पोजीशन केवल इतना ही नहीं है कि एक व्यक्ति कितना व्यापक रूप से अपने का उपयोग कर सकता है, ये उनको देख करके मुझे बड़ा प्रोत्साहन मिलता है कि मल्टीटास्किंग कैसे पॉसिबल है। तो उनके व्यक्तित्व, लेकिन फाउंडिंग एडिटर हैं, उसके साथ साथ वो वाइस प्रेसिडेंट है इंडियन सोसाइटी फॉर एग्रीकल्चरल डेवलपमेंट एंड पॉलिसी इंडिया के, और बहुत सारी चीजें हैं जिनको मैं गिनाने लगूंगा तो काफी लंबा हो जाएगा, और बल्कि मैंने कई चीजें छोड़ दी हैं जिनमें उनके लीडिंग न्यूज़पेपर्स में जो पेपर्स छपते रहे हैं, रिव्यूज छपते रहे हैं, और बहुत सारी उनकी बातें छपती रही हैं, और साथ ही साथ उनकी कई बुक्स भी पब्लिश हुए हैं, और इसके अतिरिक्त उनकी और बहुत सारी उपलब्धियां हैं। ये एक तरीका है कि हम उपलब्धियों से मनुष्य को पहचाने, किसी व्यक्ति को पहचाने और उसका सम्मान करें। लेकिन एक दूसरा तरीका भी होता है जो नितांत व्यक्तिगत स्तर पे होता है, जहां पर उसकी संवेदनशीलता, उसके कंसर्न्स समाज के लिए उसकी शक्ति को पहचानते हैं, स्वीकार करते हैं और स्वीकृति प्रदान करते हुए सम्मानित करते हैं। तो ये सारी बातें थी जो मैं आप लोगों के साथ साझा करना चाहता था डॉक्टर साहब के विषय में, और इसके साथ ही मैं वो आमंत्रित कर रहा हूँ कि वो उसके बाद हम लोग आप लोगों के साथ चर्चा करेंगे, जो भी प्रश्न होंगे डॉक्टर लेंगे आप लोगों के साथ, और लास्ट में कंक्लूड मैडम डॉक्टर हरविंदर कौर करेंगी और वोट ऑफ थैंक्स भी उसको प्रपोज करेंगी। तो मैं आमंत्रित कर रहा हूँ डॉक्टर साहब को कि वो हमारे साथ अपनी बातचीत आरंभ करें। सर वेलकम सर
थैंक यू वेरी मच डॉक्टर आशुतोष जी. वी हैव ए वेरी लॉन्ग एसोसिएशन टू डिस्कस द इश्यूज व्हिच आर ऑफ वाइटल इम्पोर्टेंस टू द सोसाइटी एट लार्ज. आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू यू एज वेल एज टू द हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट डॉक्टर हरविंदर कौर for giving me an invitation to interact with very learned audience. I know that you have been very regularly discussing the issues of national as well as local importance and academic concern, and you have been very very active person located in Ambala city, but your reach is very widespread. So I am very happy that you have been continuously carrying the spirit of promoting the wider kind of discussions and arriving at the consensus about the issues which we are all concerned about. But particularly I would like to congratulate you today that you have picked up the issue which is now globally debated. So when you talked about that it is that you are in a Sanskrit department, but I think that every individual living in India and abroad, as well as globally, people are concerned about this issue. So you are not no exception. So I am very happy that you have picked up this issue, and we shall be able to discuss this issue threadbare. But as you know that you have proposed several questions, and the laws which the names are very long, and sometimes very difficult to remember the law three names. And I always when giving lectures, I prioritize which must be the root cause of the problems which we are all discussing. So with these words, I would like to express my gratitude to all of you, and the especially the principal, my friend Dr. Rajinder Singh ji. So I have been coming to your college, but due to COVID-19, this discussion could have been face to face, but we are online. So that when I come to your college, and a lot of good hospitality interaction, and I enjoyed company of various people over there. So I am grateful to all of you. My good morning and welcome to all the participants. And when I would like to talk to you is the first thing, let us talk about that what is the situation of the Indian population in the country. This is a unique country called India, which has around 60% of the population living in the rural areas, and nearly 40% of the population lives in the urban areas. And regularly people are shifting from rural areas to urban area because the growth of the urban cities are partly the natural growth, but largely it is the migration which is taking place from rural areas to urban areas. So I think this is the fact which when Dr. Ashutosh talked about that I also belong to the category of farmers, I think that the people living in urban areas, they have a direct and indirect linkages with the rural area as well as with the farming community. So therefore you'll find that it is a concern of everybody. It is not the concern of a one person or a one section of society at all. More so that India today is in a position to feed our 1.3 billion large population, which I can say 1/6 person of the world is Indian. So that means you are feeding to 1/6 of the persons and have a capacity to feed more people worldwide. When the food is relatively short in supply, if we look at the FAO figures, the FAO is time and again warning that you will find that food shortages are expected to happen, and you will find food prices are expected to go skyrocket. So therefore, you will find that one has to look very seriously on this issue, that food is going to be very, very important. In the millennial development goals, you will find that, and the sustainable development goals, you will find that zero hunger is our aim of the world population, which is very difficult, and that is going to depend upon how farming in India goes on. So therefore, with these words, I would like to talk to you the another fact, that is that in India, largely farming is not commercial. Even if the people may be participating in the market, but for a short while when there is a harvesting time, but in the lean period, they purchase food grains. So therefore, you'll find that 86% of the farming population in India is small and marginal, which is not self-sufficient even in terms of producing the food for themselves. And you'll find that they may sell a part of the food during the part time of harvesting, but they repurchase it when there is a lean period. So therefore, this is a matter of livelihood of those people. The agriculture is engagement as well as a livelihood issue. It is not a commercial, it is not a trade issue. So therefore, you'll find that the when you talk about trade as well as the commerce, it is a very small population of the agriculturist which is actually interacting in the market. But those who are living in Punjab and Haryana, perhaps they cannot accept these facts which I am speaking, because the Punjab and Haryana is very exceptional in the post-grain revolution with a huge investment. Even small and marginal farmers are having food surpluses which they have been producing and selling it in the market. So their interaction is very wide. So that's why when you look in terms of participation in the protest, the large amount of farmers from Punjab and Haryana is participating. The reason is fundamental, that they have been understanding that when they interact with the market, how it is difficult and what kind of miseries which it is going to be proposing for them. But having said this, the another fact, third fact I would like to bring to your all concerned sitting here listening to me, that is, since November 26th, when the BBC reported that this is the largest protest in the history of the world, and this is going to largest and longest, I think, is going to be in a one past century. So I think this is a very serious, and since then, and even prior to that, largely people have debated it, the issue, and there are large amount of opinion which is available in the public domain. Even the people from literature after 26th of November, huge amount of literature has been developed. If you, in terms of poems, in terms of short stories, in terms of the kind of songs. So culture and poets and prose and everything is affected. The largest newspapers in the world, they are bringing stories after story about going in the agitation as well as engaging the farmers in terms of interviews, experts, and bringing out such kind of stories. So in such a kind of situation, sometimes it is very difficult to clearly express that what is exactly the problem which lies at. The second very important issue which I would like to bring to your kind attention is that government and farmers leaders have engaged in talks and discussions in terms of reaching the agreement. They partly, you'll find that in public domain, what is in the public domain is that the government has started conceding slowly, that some of the worrying features in the bills, which they consider are worrying one, are very serious, and they have openly given the invitation to the farmers that you can express your doubts and we are willing to remove those doubts. So why this stalemate which is continuing and agreement is not being reached? You'll find that again you'll have a matter of interpretation on the basis of laws and regulations. Having said all this, I would like to bring your attention to three act which has been passed by the government of India, starting on June 5th, bringing all of a sudden three ordinances. And then you'll find that that was the peak period of COVID and fears were very high. So government chosen the particular kind of circumstances to deal with this situation. Though when any ordinance is to be brought in, the government has to give a justification that what are the kind of emergency that allows the government to bring ordinances, not to engage in the public participation as well as the elected representative of the country. So therefore you'll find that when three ordinances were brought in, the agriculture was not in any crisis which was not before known to the government or to the community or to the intellectuals at all. So there was no circumstances where we can say that there was a need for the ordinances. So I think that if you look the doubts which has been expressed by large number of people and the farmer agitation also expressing, I think doubts are sown, the seeds of doubt were sown because the ordinances route was chosen by the government. So that was the fundamental one has to take care of, that this is the doubt which, you know, the intentions of the government was not considered by the people, for them the laws are being made. But when I consider that the three laws which are dealing with the agriculture, I think that these are not only agriculture, these are dealing with the all the population living on Indian continent, in the Indian continent. So therefore you'll find that in whole of India, anybody lives in India, the concerns are there because of the amendment which has been made in the Essential Commodities Act of 1955. So I would not like to take up the Agriculture Direct two acts, but first I would like to take the problematic issue which is the Essential Commodities Amendment Act 2020. So when we read, when we shall read both together, the 1955 Essential Commodities Act as well as the current act, you will find that very important issues that emerges out of it. So the first issue which I would like to talk to you is that in the 1955 Essential Commodities Act, the Government of India ensured, Government of India ensured that the food grains which and other essential items which are usually having fluctuation prices and the shortages are usually occurring, some are getting, some are not getting, to smoothen the supply throughout in India, they have brought in Essential Commodities Act. And you'll find that they have also included food grains and food stuff, which includes edible oil seeds as well as edible oils. So I think that this is where you'll find that the some problems when you read the previous one and the Amendment Act, the problems going to begin. When we read the 1955 Essential Commodities Act, it is clearly written that I would like to read it out for all of you to, you know, underline the issue which are involved. Essential Commodities Declaration Act, etc. For the purpose of this act, essential commodity means a commodity specified in the schedule. Number two. Subject to provisions of subsection 4, the central government may, if it is satisfied that it is necessary so to do in the public interest and for reason to be specified in the notification published in the official gazette, amend the schedule so as to, number A, add a commodity to the said schedule, B, remove any commodity from the said schedule in consultation with the state governments. So this is very important, that ए गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया कैन इंक्लूड और कैन एक्सक्लूड एनी कमोडिटीज फ्रॉम द एसेंशियल कमोडिटीज एक्ट बट इन कंसल्टेशन विद द स्टेट गवर्नमेंट. नाउ व्हेन अमेंडमेंट इन दिस वाज मेड एंड इंक्लूडिंग सम कमोडिटीज एंड दोज कमोडिटीज विच यू विल बी एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट that they have clubbed into the commodities like all the commodities, essential commodities, into the supply of such foodstuffs. They are defining now foodstuffs. Foodstuff was one item in the 1955 Act. Now foodstuff was one item. Food grains were separate. Food crops were separate in the 1955 Act. Now, what they have been doing here is that in the Essential Commodities Act, foodstuffs, including cereals, then they have in the other act, which we have Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion Act, in which they define cereals again. So, you know, they have included all kind of produce which is being produced by the farmers into the foodstuffs. Even in the natural farm, that means the wheat standing in the fields is a foodstuff, which you'll find that it's a kind of thing which is very, very differently now done. So cereals, pulses, potatoes, onions, edible oil seeds and oils, as the central government may be notification in the official gadget specify, may be regulated only under extraordinary circumstances, which may include war, famine, extraordinary price rise, and natural calamity to grave nature. So you'll find that the definition of the foodstuff is completely changed, which is not even internationally acceptable. So this is a worrying feature, which you'll find that have created large number of doubts. Now, why it is the definition has been expanded and changed and make highly inclusive? The reason are, number one, that large number of legal experts of India, they have talked about that you'll find that the agriculture is a state subject. But you know, the even agriculture, if is in concurrent list, that is not expected to be, you know, government should be able to legislate. So therefore, you'll find that when we look in terms of legislations, the Constitution of India has three divisions, which are very broad. One is the rights and duties of the citizens of India. Any individual who is living in India and abroad, they have a constitutional rights. So that means if the government of India has to legislate on the individual rights, then you'll find that the state and the central government also comes into the picture. But some rights are only being, you know, expressed by the central government, and other rights are given to the states. But there is a clear division between the duties and the rights given to the states as well as to the central government. And there are commons that is on concurrent list. So therefore, you'll find that agriculture has been from the very beginning is in the state list. So now you'll find that the three laws which are about agriculture sector of the economy that falls under the you know, category of state list. Therefore, you'll find that it is widely held view now that this limit of the states have been crossed by the central government and without consultation. And you'll find that recently the RTI has revealed that government has not shown any records of consultation on these laws to the states of India. So I think that in fact, the one of the doubts which when we talk about that apprehensions which you have been talking about, they are the manner in which these laws has been enacted. So I think that this is very seriously one has to look into, that these need not to be taken into consideration because these are the hard facts which one has to look into, that the Constitution of India is almost every citizen has a right to read it. And when you read this Constitution, you will find clearly defined duties of the central government as well as the state governments, and the division which is very sharp. But agriculture from the very beginning has been given here. This is very important, but you'll find that the two facts we have also simultaneously to note here. The one is that when we enter into global agreements, you'll find that it is the prerogative of the central government. And usually the state governments need to be taken into consideration when you have to, take the international decisions. So usually it is believed that the World Trade Organization, as well as during the pandemic times, the United States of America has pushed very seriously to the Indian government that this is a high time that you must allow the access of the markets to your agriculture sector there, which is a long overdue. And you have been, the government of India was defending it. The reason was that 86% of the farmers were small and marginal, and it is their livelihood issue. So when livelihood matters comes, then you will find that no international agency can dare to, take any decision on this. So therefore, you'll find that this is a fundamental area where one has to discuss things in a manner to understand that why these laws have come into being and why they have came into existence. The second very important aspect which one has to look into it is, before going into that, I would like to tell you that when we read these laws, they are relatively very complex, and that requires a lot of expertise in terms of even legal matters, as well as the circumstantial evidence, as well as what are the intentions which are directly reflecting from the laws, and what are the unintended consequences which are going to happen. So sometimes, the intentions may be right, but unintended consequences may not be, in favor of. So then you have to rethink about whatever you have done. So I think that interpretation of these laws is very, very important. And from one definition, you can say the whole lot of the spirit of the issue completely changes. So whenever I talk to you that foodstuff, the foodstuff is in the concurrent list, and relatively it is a processing. So whatever the processing, even wheat is processed in the flour, and even simple atta, that is a foodstuff. But wheat is not a foodstuff. But they have included the term cereal, and even in the natural form, that takes in terms of even the wheat standing in the field is now the foodstuff. So I think this is where you'll find that the definition was extended, and that has created a lot of doubts about the legality, and you'll find that the intentions which usually the national government is going to have about these kind of things. The second very important aspect which we would like to talk is that when you'll find that allowing the stocks of the food grains to the private companies or individual, any individual who is having a PAN card, you will find that enter into the agriculture trade and can store whatever the amount of the stocks they would like to have. Okay, but even if the private are going to have stocks, you'll find that there is a possibility that government can have a regulation, and government, whenever required, those stocks can be taken for a public use. But you'll find that the further definitions which they have given, these stocks which are unlimited in nature, and also they have talked about that if any company who has stocks, food stocks accumulated, you will find that what they can do is that if they are involved in global value chains, means they are manufacturing, and then you'll find supplying those products nationally as well as internationally, in any circumstances, even defined by the government, emergency and all that, war and all that, you cannot ask them to unload their stocks at all. Even if you have a starvation, but the government even wants those stocks to be released for them, and government want to purchase, you'll find that that is not even, you'll find that allowed here in terms of those who are engaged in the global value chains or value chains. Now, value chains, you'll find that all the companies, those who are nowadays are engaged in food trade, they are in the value chain system. Therefore, that means whether a company is national, whether is a company is foreigner, whatever the amount of food they have stocked, you cannot ask them, even in the case of emergency, that you give us the food stock. So therefore, you'll find that in 1955 Essential Commodities Act and today's the Essential Commodities Amendment 2020 Act, you'll find that this is the big change which has happened. That means if food stocks available cannot be unloaded, even if the prices goes very high. The second issue which talks about prices, the prices that they have talked about, that if commodities are perishable, they allow if a product is purchased of 100, they can sell at 200 rupees. So 100% rise in prices are allowed. In terms of the durable or non-perishable, 50% of the price, that if you are buying today of 100 rupees, today you can sell at 150 rupees. So therefore you'll find that the price rise is expected to be very high. So that means at what prices and when the government has to regulate these kind of prices, perhaps government knows better than anybody else, because you'll find that it seems that until the public pressure will not happen, you will find that nobody will be going to bother about food grain prices. The food grain prices can multiply and food inflation can happen. You will find that that is not going to be dealt with the government at all. So this is a kind of a freedom which has been given to the government. You will find that government has given this freedom to the private traders. That is a tremendous and gives a doubt. And you'll find that the third very important issue, which is circumstantial evidence. If you look at Moga city of Punjab, the one company of India has developed a silos, 2 lakh metric tons food can be stocked at a time, and the railway goes directly there. Okay, tomorrow, if you'll find that the whole stock of food is there, but you'll find that government wants, they will say no, they can take anywhere they would like to have. So that means food is going to be controlled by the big companies. That is the fundamental aspect which is going to happen. The third very important issue which emerges from this Essential Commodities Amendment Act, that is that in the previous 1955 Act, the government of India was responsible in terms of fair prices to the consumers and remunerative prices, minimum support price to the farmers. Now, this is completely set aside. So that means nowadays, the fair prices to the consumers will not be given by the government, as well as fair prices to the farmers will not be insured by the government. So that is where you'll find that once this acts are in operation, you'll find that the food trade has been gone into the hands of the private traders. Then you'll find that the remunerative prices, whether it is available to the farmer or not, will not be the responsibility of the government. and the fair price to the consumer will not be the responsibility of the government. So that means both consumers as well as producers are going to be affected by this amendment which has been made. So therefore you'll find that this is very, very important. And third very important aspect is that if you are allowing the food stocks to be stocked unlimitedly by the companies, then you'll find that tomorrow government says that why we shall buy the foods for the Food Security Act. The food is available with the private. If need be, we will get it, or we can, you know, give a direct money transfer rather than giving food transfer. So that means the whole lot of government's interventions in the process of this food business is going to be completely set aside. So this brings in the suspicion of largely the experts as well as of the farmers, that is that the minimum support price is automatically going to be redundant. So that means the Essential Commodities Act amendment without consultation of the states of India is perhaps a hugely problematic, and constitutionally it is not the right step which has been taken by the government. And I think that my suggestion will be at the end that the government of India should form a National Agriculture Development Council, where you'll find that the chief minister and agriculture ministers of the state should be participant elected representatives, as well as the stakeholders, farmers organizations must also be included, and some experts who are reasonably good, they should also be included, and even those people in the judiciary who have legislated on it, they must also be partly included in that, so that consensus should be built that what is the change or amendment in the Essential Commodities Act is suitable to the India as a whole, that should be done, and both to the consumers as well as to the stakeholders, that is the farmers. So second act which I would like to talk to you, that is the another two acts. One is the Farmers Empowerment Protection Agreement Price Assurance and Farm Services Act. The another one was the Farmers Produce Trade Commerce Promotion and Facilitation Act of 2020. Now, these two acts are already in operation in most of the states of India, except two which I know very well. One is Bihar, which dismantled these kind of acts which was in operation in 2006. So there are no Agriculture Produce Market Acts in the year in Bihar, and it was in the year 2006 when these were repealed over there. Second is Kerala government, which has never from the very beginning has had these kind of laws. So therefore you'll find that except these two states, the other states of India are having these two laws in various forms, which is perhaps in operation for a long period of time. But I will tell you that even if the minimum support price was given by the central government on 23 crops, applicable only 2.5 crops, I can say. One is wheat, another is paddy rice. Third is, which is half, I can say, is cotton. So you will find that the other crops, you will find that do not have. In most of the states of India, except Punjab, Haryana, and Western Uttar Pradesh, the minimum support prices are not applicable. So therefore, you'll find that the central, because historically, in the year 1966 onward, when PL 480 US law, PL 480, under which we have got food aid, and after that, we started looking very seriously the agriculture sector of the economy. And then you'll find that the food surpluses were only produced by 2.5 states. Two states, one is Punjab and Haryana, another was Western Uttar Pradesh. No other state of India after 1966 till the middle of 80s do not have surplus food grains with them at all. Even they were not able to fulfill their own needs. And this is the history which one has to understand. And this is the contribution which you have to understand from the period 1966 till date. Largely the national pool are able to get food grains from these three states. And that has saved us historically in terms of providing food safety, security. And then you'll find that even they are the states which allowed Indian government to earn foreign exchange as well as give food aid to other countries of the world. So India was made proud of by these two and a half states of India. That's why you will find that the history is very important, that these two states, on the basis of minimum support price and public procurement by the government of India, that given a security to the farmers also to produce huge amount of food grains from a smaller area. So the productivity in these two states in terms of doing our research and development expenditure, developing new food seed varieties, fertilizers, pesticides, and everything. So therefore, the huge amount of infrastructure which has been created, like APMC mandis, played a very important role in terms of collection of the food for the central government. So therefore, you'll find that historically, the infrastructure which has been developed in these two states, for example, in Punjab and Haryana, the number of mandis available to the farmers is less than 30 kilometers, square kilometers. So that means a farmer, when has to travel with food to be sold out, he is expected to travel less than 30 kilometers. Okay, but you go to Madhya Pradesh, 700 kilometers a farmer has to travel to get a mandi. So that means the infrastructure created by the governments of Punjab and Haryana, you will find in Western Uttar Pradesh where the food was collected. And therefore, you will find that these are the states which historically provided to the nation food security. Dr. Ashutosh, I would like to inform you and the other members of the audience that in the mid-80s, we have doing analysis of agriculture, food grain, rice in other states of India also. We found at that particular point of time that if 1% rise in the rate of growth of the Indian agriculture, then you'll find that the food surpluses of Punjab and Haryana will not be required. So therefore, you'll find that we proposed at that time that there should be a diversification of Punjab and Haryana and Western Uttar Pradesh from purely, you know, specializing in food crops to other crops. This proposal was routed through the government of Punjab to the central government. The central government said this is a matter of food security. Therefore, we will not allow Punjab and Haryana to change the cropping patterns. So that means, if nation needs, and these two states have provided huge amount of food security and worked for them, and today you will find all of a sudden you are saying that everything must go to the market, we are not responsible now. Okay, so this is a very, very important problem. But when we talk about this Farmers Produce Trade Commerce and Promotion Facilitation Ordinance, you will find that 2-3 things are very important to be talked about. The one is that here you'll find that again from the Essential Commodities Act, where they have changed, because I was thinking that why Essential Commodities Act was, you know, amended, and it was correlated to the agriculture sector itself. So, you know, the definition which I have talked to you previously, the definition of foodstuffs, when it has included here in this act, you will find that that act has been included cereals, and cereals are defined including the wheat, rice, and other food grains, including in a natural form. So I think this is a too extreme kind of, you know, definition of the, you know, foodstuffs, which you will find that extended, because that foodstuffs as a term is in the concurrent list, and therefore you'll find that instead of the agriculture produce and market, they have talked about trade and commerce. So that means central government can legislate on it. Okay, so you'll find that this is how, you know, the small change, which is not perhaps visible to large number of people, in the Essential Commodities Act is included here. So that if you seriously, or anybody who's seriously reading, you'll find doubts are very clearly expressed the way things have been done, and no consultation with the states, and their rights are being abrogated. And you'll find that these two acts, which are related to the farmers, they are actually, they are actually superseding the right of the state to legislate on it. Therefore, you'll find that the some states like Kerala, which has recently passed assembly resolution, and that is asking the repealing of laws, because it is the state's rights has been encroached upon by the central government. So I think that the fundamental problem in these laws is the one very important aspect which I have been talking to you has been that the constitutional provisions, which has been not favoring the central government, but central government has started legislating. But historically, I would like to talk to you that from the last decade or so, the central government was giving advice to the state governments to amend their APMC acts, as well as you would like to also amend the Contract Act. So then you'll find that these two acts, which has been advised 20 states of India in various forms, looking at the local circumstances, has made consonance with the central government's advice. So that means even the state governments are not avoiding the advice of the central government. So therefore you'll find that it is not actually required that this central government all of a sudden should bring in these laws, and you'll find that the superseding those laws which are existing. But one of the very important aspect, which is a claim of the government, which is very important, you will find that one is that they say when the food is sold out by the farmer and purchased by the central government or any other agency, which is even private, you'll find that the state governments are charging taxes on it. And this tax varied from 2.5% to 8.5%. So this is, they are saying that if India should have a one market like GST, which we have talked about, that we have the same rates of GST, okay? And why not same rates of food purchase? When we are purchasing food, the same amount of taxes to be uniform taxes, which we can call, can be imposed. So you will find that I agree on this issue, that this is a very genuine kind of issue, where you will find that differential rates of taxes imposed on the purchaser when the purchase happens. Okay, if government of India proposed laws that a uniform tax is to be imposed on the purchase of the food grains, acceptable, no problem. But now what they have done, told that they say no fee will be charged purchase of food that will be purchased by the private agencies, those who are having only PAN card. So that means you'll find that the issue, which was genuine, but you'll find that the resolution is hugely different. That means the state governments are completely going to depend. For example, the states which are agriculturally developed states of India, they have been hugely raising taxes, and then developmental activities are carried out of that. So that means now even GST is imposed at the state level. Earlier it was resting with the state, now going to the national government, then coming from there. And some of the states are not getting 3 months, 6 months revenue. They have to borrow and then fulfill their duties. So that means even now, the less revenue which is going to happen, even the agriculturally developed states of India, so their dependence on the central government is going to happen. So I think that the state governments which are not agreeing to these laws, the fundamental problem is that the revenue increasingly, for revenue purposes, we are continuously, more and more dependence is going to be on the center, where you'll find that the constitution has given a provisions that the states and the third tier of government should be independent. They should raise their own resources. But what we have been doing is centralization. So that means you'll find that the development process of the state is now in the hands of the central government. So this is very important that the taxes which are going to be, if you have a single market, the taxes to be imposed, it has given a freedom of taxes. Now, I would like to talk to you that what is the reason of not imposing any tax? The reason is that the central government knows that APMC mandis, even though in the acts are superseded, government will be soon going to make an amendment that those can also operate. And today you will find that the one of the negotiation which is going on, they say this amendment can be made. So they say that on the APMC markets which are operating, when they charge 2.5% or more taxes on the purchaser, that means your produce is going to be higher priced. But when you are going to the outside these mandis, then you'll find that those taxes are not there. That means they can offer 2.5% more to the producer, and then you'll find that the producer can shift to their mandis. So that means you are giving a rather than level playing field, you are giving absolute advantage to the private traders to purchase food. And you'll find that the experience of the dismantling of APMC Act in Bihar shows that the even minimum support prices of paddy are 1800, but today they are getting 700 to 900 per quintal. So I think this is hugely the half, and even in Punjab also, the maize is being, having a minimum support price of 1400, but you'll find that the farmers are getting 800 to 900 rupees because minimum support price is not imposed on that. The government is not buying that. So therefore, you'll find that this is the price which is, not remunerative, which is actually happening. So that means that if this is a fear of the farmers, the kind of empirical evidence which is available, factual evidence which is available, that shows us that if minimum support price is not announced by the central government, and even if it is announced by the central government, it is not, the purchase is not being done by the central government, then, or state government, then you will find that the half the price the farmers are going to get. So that means the farmers are expected to have losses. And I would like to remind you that 1991 up to now, there are 30 years of reforms, that the farmers are reeling under debt. The reason was two. One was that the amount of inputs which farmers are purchasing, their prices are continuously rising. You can see the diesel, which was very, very low priced, nowadays the diesel is very highly priced. Similarly, the other inputs which the farmer is using, you will find that hugely prices have increased. What is important is that minimum support price is rising, but not at the rate at which the input prices are rising. So therefore, you'll find that the farmers have lost hugely in terms of doing more investment while borrowing money and accumulating debts. And if you see clearly the national figures, the agriculture income in the national income has gone down from 34-35% of the national income to 14% now. So that means a huge decline, and the dependence of the workforce absolutely has increased. So that is, you'll find that the per capita availability of income has hugely declined. This is number one. Second is that the social services, which was the responsibility of the central as well as the state governments, they are recovering the prices out of that. Education is very costly, medical health services are very costly, so they have to pay more on that. So that means you'll find that this is usually, you'll find the squeezing the farming community as well as rural community as such, even a middle class. And then you'll find that the debt accumulation is increasing. If you see the kind of suicides committed, I would like to say no state in India has been exception where farmers have not committed suicides. Somewhere it is reported very clearly, somewhere it was not reported very clearly, but this was the issue, very important. And even today you will find that the farmers keep on committing suicide. So that means the kind of the system which we have developed over a period of time, already the huge development transformation which is taking place, that is transforming resources or the surpluses from the agriculture to the industry and other sectors of the economy, services. But you will find that the farmers are being squeezed over a long period of time. So this is the 30 years period of crisis which has been built over a period of time, and it is expected that these laws are absolutely going to give favor to that kind of transformation which we have been building over a period of time, which Ashutosh ji, you have been asking question, that the market economy which we have imposed from very beginning and nakedly from the 1991, how long agriculture will be saved. I think that this historically, I would like to talk to you that in the year 1891, if you read the history of United States of America, at that time a similar kind of transformation was taking place in the United States of America also. In the early 1890s, the farmers were committing suicides there also because of high degree of indebtedness, squeezing the agriculture income and falling prices of, and the private are not paying the prices the way they have been paid. So then what the farmers did was, then you know, they organized themselves, they not only agitated, but they contested the elections even of the president. They were able to, you know, not able to win the presidency, but they are able to win huge amount of Senate elections. And then you'll find that they changed the laws, and then they protected the farmers at that particular point of time, that giving huge amount of subsidies. Today, US agriculture income, 50% of the total income is a subsidy. So therefore you'll find that the huge amount of, even Japan, 60-70%, in the whole of Europe, 40%. So 40% of the income of the farmers is a direct subsidy given by these countries of the world. India uniquely is not recognizing this important fact, that historically we have seen that this kind of problem which occurs, and this kind of solutions are available, but you will find that we are not able to understand these kind of solutions which have been tried by the East Asian countries, European countries, and you will find that in North American countries. So therefore you will find that if such kind of things are happening worldwide, you will find that we should learn a lesson from those countries, and then you will find that apply these kind of the apart from, you will find this, the most important aspect is that when you propose any laws, how disputes, if occurs, can be solved. Now you will find that one of the very important aspect here, you will find that we understand today that the framework of the government and the bureaucracy which we have with us is highly plied bureaucracy. For example, that if the state government is in power, and the bureaucracy, if there is a BJP or a Congress or any other party, you will find that they are more attuned to party whims and fancies rather than, you will find that, independently functioning. Similarly happening in the judiciary also nowadays, but you will find that the judiciary is relatively, still we can say, is not as known to all of us, interfering in that level. But you will find that the bureaucracy, we can understand very well. The whole load of dispute, if occurs, has been loaded on bureaucracy. and consider that bureaucracy is very efficient. Okay, so we all know in the current circumstances that bureaucracy is not at all efficient one, and you will find that clearly in these laws the courts are barred to pick up any matters related to farming. So I think this is the, if dispute occurs in both the laws, you will find that the it is clearly written the civil court is barred. I think this is a kind of fundamental rights of the any person, including farmers, has been withdrawn through these laws. So that is, I think, is a kind of if there are suspicion, the suspicion is in the ground in such kind of laws. Third very important aspect which I would like to talk to you, that is the in the contract law, the contracts are very important. And before I going to contract, I would like to talk about intermediary. Now you'll find that the claim of the government is that these new laws are evicting the intermediaries from the purchase, because farmers can sell directly to the purchaser. Now in the same very laws, it has been talked about that a trader can be intermediary also. So that means you are also admitting in these laws that for any trader can be on others' behalf, can purchase. So I think that this is, you'll find that intermediary is not evicted. So the claim is that we are giving direct interaction between the farmer as well as the trader. But you'll find that simultaneously it is being talked about that if you, in the APMC Act, you would like to say that the intermediary like RTAs are exploiting, but similarly, the same RTAs are going to be intermediary for the companies. The difference will be that now the RTAs are getting some amount of assured percentage of the value of the output sold out. They will renegotiate, will have a lower value. That is true. That I agree that they will have lower, but intermediary are not going to last. The important aspect which I would like to talk to you is that the big companies, for example, if I can say Adani and Ambani or Tata's, if they enter into the food grains, you will find that why Tata will go to 2.5 acre producer of a farm produce to purchase from him. He would like to have a bigger deals. Okay, and that means to small intermediaries will be there, and then you will find that they will be integrated with the bigger one, trader. So that means there is an intermediary kind of things going to happen. So if we know the marketing system as such, you will find that marketing is always through intermediaries. You have a wholesaler, you have a retailer, okay, you have a distributor, and you'll find that all kind of chains are going to be there. And in the Essential Commodities Act, it is talked about value chains. So that means these are the chains where you have to agree. Even if you are buying even a chocolate, you will find that from where it started and from where the coca is being purchased and they ultimately delivered to the consumer, huge number of intermediaries are going to be there. So intermediary should not be exploitative. The laws have not ensured that the intermediary should not be exploitative. So intermediary eviction doesn't mean that intermediary is not going to be exploitative. So the fundamental problem in the existing laws is exploitation. So if exploitation continues, then you'll find that the intermediary, even if removed, doesn't make much sense in that term of the term. So the contract farming law, which I would like to talk to you, is having a similar kind of dispute management system, which you will find that civil courts are being debarred. So that is a fundamental intention of the government, where you will find that bureaucracies seem to be more effective, and you'll find that the government can adjudicate in terms of its direction, the way you'll find that the disputes are going to be settled. So you'll find that the courts are being debarred. That's why you'll find that this law has generated another big constituency in India, because lawyers are intermediary between the courts and the farmers. And then you'll find that their business is also going to be affected. So therefore, if lawyers are supporting the agitation, you will find that their income is expected to be at stake. So therefore, you'll find that you have to, why government has created such kind of, you know, a constituency for supporting these, opposing these kind of laws. I cannot understand that why the experts in the government could have simply understood these kind of matters, which are very easier to be, you know, taken care of. Third very important aspect which I would like to talk and end my talk, and then we will have a discussion, because we should have more time for discussion. That is that the contractor of the farm produce is going to be called as service provider. So that means that the all services related to the agriculture is expected to be provided by the person who is a contractor. So now contractor, when is providing services, that means the outcome which is going to be there, why quality check then will be done? The quality check will be done by the service provider again when the produce is final, okay? And then you'll find that if that is not of that quality, the farmer is at stake. So then you learn farmers' exploitation is built in the system, and we have not built any infrastructure linkages. For example, if I talk to you very clearly, the 2021 budget presented by the government of India has given a clear signals that agriculture is going to be in the hands of the private in terms of promoting infrastructure. So that means quality laboratories, quality checks need to be, you know, done by the government, and that should be an independent agency. So if the laboratories are of the service provider, and the quality check will be done by the service provider, and the disputes are going to be, if there arises of the by the bureaucracy, then I think that the fundamental problem is that these laws generate a large amount of suspicion, and then you'll find that the fundamental problem is that these laws have some kind of exploitative features which are going to be more severe compared to the existing ones. The final issue I would like to talk to you is that the price fluctuations are expected to happen, and that happened to be a very large extent, and that can ruin the small and marginal peasantry very easily. With if one crop fails, the farmers is almost under debt, and then you'll find that the whole life cannot come out of debt. So you know that if there is a any fluctuations in prices which is going to happen, which is there is no assurance on that, then you'll find that the problem is these fluctuations are going to, you know, dismantle the huge amount of 86% of the small and marginal farmers very easily, because they don't have any resilience. But you'll find that I do not bother if we have alternative sources of employment for such a large amount of population. So if we as India, for the period of long period of time from the 1947 till date of independence, India is not able to hugely transfer its population from rural areas to industrial sector of the economy, because industrial sector is not, you know, engine of growth of the economy. Service sector do not have a capacity to absorb, because large amount of skills which has been with them, those are not usable anywhere except in the industry. So therefore, you'll find that we don't have the kind of industrial sector of the economy where you'll find that the security of the people who will be uprooted from agriculture can get employment and better living condition. Until we are not creating such kind of conditions, I think that we should not allow the kind of laws, procedures, or the circumstances where you'll find the large number of people are expected to die with starvation, deaths and all that. So because of non-availability of the basic services as well as of the food grains, and I would like to remind you that when starvation deaths reached to the Supreme Court of India during the times of Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, then you'll find that the government filed an affidavit stating that even food grains are spoiled in the godowns, but you'll find that it is not possible to give free food to the poor who are suffering from starvation and dying with starvation deaths. So I think that the government from a very beginning have a clear mandate not to provide food even those people who are starving. But later on you will find that because of public pressure and due to democratic system, you'll find that the government has to bring a Food Security Act, where you'll find that the food is expected to be given to the people at a very low prices or free of cost. So I think that here I would like to conclude stating that these laws which are that going to have one common market, and you'll find the efficiency in the agriculture production, more infrastructure development by the private sector, all these kind of benefits can occur. But it is not a binary that today you have supported everything by the state and tomorrow you say everything go to the market. This process is expected to be gradual, and we have to see the consequences of one by one, rather than at a one stroke hugely making one large section of society at a disadvantaged position compared to the traders. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful lecture. ये तो कमाल ही हो गया. मैंने ऐसा सोचा नहीं था कि इतना सहज रूप में और इतनी आसान टर्म्स में ये सारे के सारे लॉज जो हैं वो प्रोस एंड कॉन्स के साथ आप इसको प्रस्तुत करेंगे हमारे लिए. और वाकई बहुत सारे इश्यूज जो स्वयं पढ़ने से क्लियर नहीं हो रहे थे, वो बहुत सारे इश्यूज क्लियर हुए हैं. लेकिन अल्टीमेटली मैं इस बात जरूर पहुंचा हूं कि इकोनॉमिस्ट ने किस तरह का स्ट्रक्चर खड़ा किया है कि जो इतना ह्यूज, इतना कॉम्प्लेक्स और सेल्फ कंट्राडिक्टरी है. क्योंकि गवर्नमेंट भी जो लाती है उनको भी सजेस्ट करने वाले इकोनॉमिस्ट हैं, फिर उसमें जो कमी पेशी दिखाने वाले लोग हैं वो भी इकोनॉमिस्ट हैं. तो आफ्टर मतलब एक गवर्नमेंट और कुछ नहीं है, वो तो वही करेगी जो उनको सजेस्ट किया जाएगा, जो डाटा जिस तरह का प्रोवाइड किया जाएगा. सो कई तरह के इश्यूज और भी मेरे मन में आ रहे थे जहां जहां भी आपने ये बातें सारी लेकर के की हैं. लेकिन बाई एंड लार्ज मुझे ये लगता है कि मतलब ये कहने का दुस्साहस ही है कि इकोनॉमिक्स को रीस्ट्रक्चर करना बहुत जरूरी है, उसको सिंप्लीफाई करना बहुत जरूरी है. बहुत ओवर कॉम्प्लेक्स हो गया है, ओवर इंटेलेक्चुअलाइज हमने इकोनॉमिक्स को कर दिया है, जो कि लोगों के लिए था, लोगों की वेलबींग के लिए था. तो उससे ये इतने सारे इश्यूज को एक साथ पकड़ पाना, समझ पाना और शेयर कर पाना बड़ा मुश्किल है. तो लेकिन खैर अब ये हाउस ओपन है आप लोगों की डिस्कशन के लिए. अगर आप लोगों की कोई ओपिनियन है, मोस्ट वेलकम. और अगर आपकी कोई एप्रीहेंशंस हैं, यू आर मोस्ट वेलकम टू शेयर. और अगर कोई और टिप्पणी आप इसके अतिरिक्त करना चाहते हैं तो इवन देन यू आर यू कैन आस्क क्वेश्चंस, रेज इश्यूज, डॉक्टर साहब विल रिप्लाई टू देम. किसी के भी कोई सवाल है, कोई टिप्पणी है? रविंद्र कुमार जी, डॉक्टर गुप्ता जी. जी सर.
सर पहले तो मैं डॉक्टर साहब का बहुत बहुत आभार व्यक्त करना चाहता हूँ कि कितने उन्होंने एनालिटिकल वे से अपनी बात बताई हमें. और मेरा कोई इनके सबमिशन है सिर्फ एक दो, और वो भी सबमिशन एक तो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से सर, और दूसरा मैं निजी अनुभव शेयर करना चाहूंगा. पहली बात सर, जो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल आपने बात कही बिल्कुल आपने सही कहा, और एक कंफ्यूजन पैदा हो गया इसके ऊपर. मैं इसलिए ज्यादा नहीं बोलूंगा क्योंकि सुप्रीम कोर्ट में मैटर सब जुडिस है इस समय, और कल ही सुप्रीम कोर्ट में जब चीफ जस्टिस ऑफ इंडिया ने ये कहा कि ये मैटर सोल्व होता दिखाई नहीं देता, तो सोलिसिटर जनरल ने उसी समय तुरंत कहा कि नहीं, ऐसी बात नहीं है, और इसलिए उन्होंने एविडेविट भी नहीं दिया है तो हो सकता है कि हो जाए। मैं सिर्फ सिर्फ एक बात कहना चाहता हूँ इस आंदोलन को लेकर कि मुझे कहीं ना कहीं लगता है कि पूरा का पूरा हमारा कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन जो है इस समय खतरे में आ गया है। क्योंकि दो बातें मैं कहना चाहता हूँ सर कि डॉक्टर अम्बेडकर जी ने जो अपना लास्ट वक्तव्य दिया है कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन असेंबली में और उन्होंने जो कहा कि भी संविधान को किन किन बातों से खतरा है तो पहला पॉइंट उन्होंने यही कहा था कि एजिटेशन से है कि हमारी सरकार है स्वराज है तो हम जो है इनको डेमोक्रेटिक वे में हटा सकते हैं, एक बात। दूसरा डॉक्टर राधाकृष्णन जी ने 14-15 अगस्त की रात्रि को जो कहा था बड़ा इम्पोर्टेंट कि सही श्रुता ही स्वराज है। तो मुझे ये लगता है सर कि ये दोनों ही बातें इस समय खतरे में आई हुई हैं, इसका सोल्व होना बहुत जरूरी है। दूसरी बात जो आपने कहा कॉन्करेंट लिस्ट और सब्जेक्ट लिस्ट को लेकर, सर मैं केवल इतना कहना चाहता हूँ सर मेरे को एक बात नहीं समझ में आई अभी तक। एक और तो ये कहा जा रहा है कि सेंटर बना नहीं सकता कानून, ओके मान लीजिए इस बात को, और कुछ राज्य सरकारों ने स्पेशल सेशन बुलाए हैं और सेशन बुलाकर यह कहा कि हमने इन लेजिस्लेशन को खत्म कर दिया जिन्हें पंजाब भी है। अब भाई यदि ये लेजिस्लेशन पंजाब में खत्म हो गया है तो फिर आंदोलन किस बात का है, पहली बात। दूसरा ऐसा कौन सा संविधान का प्रावधान है कि जिसमें किसी राज्य सरकार को क्या केंद्र द्वारा बनाए गए कानून को रद्द करने का अधिकार है? क्योंकि रद्द करने का अधिकार, अल्ट्रा वायलेंस करने का अधिकार तो सुप्रीम कोर्ट को तो है। और आपने बहुत अच्छी, जितना मैं समझा हूं सर आपने इतना वेल एनालिटिकल आपका व्यू रहा है कि जिसमें मैं समझता हूं कि जो सुप्रीम कोर्ट के रूल्स हैं जी जुडिशियल रिव्यू के लिए पिथ एंड सब्सटेंस एंड कलरेबल लेजिस्लेशन दोनों के बिहाफ पर तक आने वाले दिनों में सुप्रीम कोर्ट इसकी वैलिडिटी को चेक भी करे, तो इसलिए मैं उसके ऊपर टिप्पणी नहीं करना चाहता। एक बात और मैं कहना चाहता हूं सर, क्योंकि आपने स्पेशली मेंशन किया था हरियाणा पंजाब और वेस्टर्न यूपी, तो व्यक्तिगत रूप से सर मैं आपको बता दूं मैं वेस्टर्न यूपी से बिलोंग करता रहा हूं और एक छोटे किसान का बेटा हूं, यानी कि मैं किसान उसको मानता हूं कि जो केवल और केवल खेती पर निर्भर करता हो। और सर अनफॉर्चुनेटली मैं बता रहा हूं सर कि हमें अपना अनुभव ये है, मेरे को अपना है कि जब मेरे पिताजी बीमार हो गए पैरालिटिक पेशेंट हो गए तो मुझे मिला केवल कर्जा जो उनको चुकाना था किसान होने के नाते। दूसरा आपने 30 साल की बात की सर, मैं 30 साल से पुरानी बात बता रहा हूं कि 70 से लेकर 90 तक हमने 4 बार गन्ने की फसल को सर खेतों में आग लगाई, हमारे को वो जो पहुंचाना ना गन्ने को वो खर्चा ज्यादा पड़ रहा था। तो एमएसपी की बात हम करते हैं सर, लेकिन मेरा निजी अनुभव है कि आज तक किसी भी सरकार ने किसी भी पार्टी की हो, मेरा किसी पार्टी विशेष से आग्रह या दुराग्रह नहीं है, लेकिन कभी भी एमएसपी को लागू ही नहीं किया गया वर्तमान में। और यही हमारी किसानों की जो मांग है कि एमएसपी लाओ, एमएसपी लाओ ही नहीं सर, मैं ये कहना चाहता हूँ कि एमएसपी को एंश्योर करने का मैकेनिज्म सरकार जब तक नहीं लाएगी खाली कानून बनाने से कोई काम होने वाला नहीं है। और आपने बिल्कुल सही कहा सर, बहुत अच्छी बात कही थी कि एक आयोग बनाया जाए जिसमें किसानों के प्रतिनिधि भी हों पूरा का पूरा। मैं जो इस पूरे पॉइंट से समझ पाया हूँ सर अपना व्यक्तिगत रूप से, तो हमारी लॉ मेकिंग प्रोसेस है उसमें स्टेक होल्डर्स को नहीं पूछा जा रहा है। आपने बहुत सही कहा कि ब्यूरोक्रेसी आ रही है, और एक जो दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण स्थिति अब सर आ रही है जो बहुत देश के लिए खतरनाक है कि हम कहीं ना कहीं न्यायपालिका पर भी प्रश्न चिन्ह लगाने लगे हैं। संसद पहले ही पॉलिटिकल पार्टियों का अखाड़ा बन चुकी है, एग्जीक्यूटिव है पॉलिटिकल पार्टी की, ब्यूरोक्रेसी उनके अंडर में आ गई है। अब एक बची खुची संस्था बची है हमारे पास संविधान को और डेमोक्रेसी को बचाने की, यदि हम उसके ऊपर भी आशंका करने लगे या उनका व्यवहार ऐसा हुआ कि आशंका उत्पन्न हुई तो मुझे नहीं समझ आ रहा सर कि हमारा लोकतंत्र कैसे बचेगा। इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ सर मैं पुनः आपका बहुत बहुत आभारी हूँ, धन्यवाद करता हूँ कि आपने जिस ढंग से इन कानूनों के बारे में हमें बताया है उसके लिए आपको केवल एक, शायद मैं उन्हें आपसे बड़ा हूँ 65 साल का हो गया हूँ तो मैं आपको साधुवाद दूंगा, इतना अच्छा आपने बताया है सर, थैंक यू वेरी मच।
थैंक यू सो मच।
डॉक्टर गुप्ता जी। हाँ जी मैम हरविंदर जी।
सर मेरा, मैं सबसे पहले तो डॉक्टर लखविंदर सिंह जी का बहुत बहुत वेलकम करना चाहती हूँ, उन्होंने हमारा निमंत्रण स्वीकार किया। और इन दिनों पर मैं और आशुतोष जी कई बार बात करते थे, सर कहते थे कि पहले तो हमें ये जानना है ये बिल है क्या, अच्छे हैं या बुरे हैं वो बाद की बात है, जो भी आया है पहले हम इस बारे में बात करते हैं। तो बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर, एक तो आपने बहुत ही इंफॉर्मेटिव ये लेक्चर था आपका। सर मैं थोड़ा सा इस बारे में स्टडी कर लेती हूँ, किसान की बेटी हूँ, बड़ी नजदीक से किसान की जिंदगी को देखा है, उसके अच्छे और बुरे सारे वक्त को देखा है। मुझे पता है सर, मैं नहीं जानती मीडिएटर सरकार क्यों आजकल ये बात करती है कि आड़तियों के चंगुल में है। आड़ती तो सर कहीं हमें ऐसा लगता था, मेरे फादर अक्सर कहा करते थे कि जब भी हम आड़ती से पैसा लेते हैं ना, वो एक पर्दा रखता है। पर बेटी की शादी में लिया, किसी को कानो कान खबर नहीं होती थी इस किसान ने बेटी की शादी कर्ज लेकर की है। बैंक से जब कर्जा लेते हैं तो बैंक तो बाहर वो डिफॉल्टर का पोस्टर लगा देता है। और मेरे, मैं सौभाग्य की बात है सर, एक और मैं गुरनाम सिंह चढ़ूंगी जी जो है किसान यूनियन के प्रधान है, जो इस टाइम हरियाणा के, उसके प्राउड गांव से बिलोंग करती हूँ, उस गांव की बेटी हूँ। तो अंकल जी से मेरी बड़ी डिटेल में बात होती है, घर अपने पहले बाद में जाती हूँ, पहले अंकल के घर जाया करती हूँ। तो अंकल भी कहते हैं कि देखो जिसका, कि मैंने खुद सहा है, देखा है सर, कि जिसका बाहर बैंक के बाहर पोस्टर पे नाम लिखा है डिफॉल्टर घोषित करके किसान को, उसके बच्चों के रिश्ते नहीं होते सर, उसका समाज में बायकॉट हो जाता है। और कई किसान बड़े शर्मसार होते हैं सर, इवन ये सब सुसाइड का एक कारण बन जाता है। तो इन बिलों के बारे में मैं भी थोड़ा बहुत स्टडी कर लेती हूँ सर, कोशिश करती हूँ, पढ़ती रहूँ, या अपने छोटे जो ब्रदर हैं, भाई हैं गांव में जो है, उनको इसके बारे में बताने की कोशिश करती हूँ। सबसे बड़ा भय वैसे तो सब तीनों ही बिल, जहां तक मैं देखती हूँ मुझे बड़े संदेह के रहता है, चाहे वो प्रोजेक्ट फार्मिंग का हो, चाहे वो ट्रेड और कॉमर्स का हो, सरकार कहीं ना कहीं अपनी बचना चाहती है। बट कॉन्ट्रैक्ट फार्मिंग तो हमें और दूर ले जाएगा सर, मुझे तो ऐसा लगता है कि कॉन्ट्रैक्ट फार्मिंग के कारण कहीं क्रॉप्स का कमर्शियलाइजेशन ही ना हो जाए, फूड ग्रेन की शॉर्टेज ही ना हो जाए। जिसको हम कहते हैं बड़ा प्रोस्पर है हरियाणा पंजाब, अभी अभी आपने बताया कि अगर 1% भी यहाँ पर ग्रोथ रेट ज्यादा हो गई तो हम यहाँ की प्रोडक्टिविटी को संभाल नहीं पाएंगे। लॉ ऑफ डिमांड और सप्लाई एकदम से वो जो लागू होगा, प्राइसेस पहले ही ऑलरेडी कम होते हैं, तो कॉन्ट्रैक्ट फार्मिंग भी तो एक बड़ा भय रहेगा कि हम टोटली कमर्शियलाइजेशन की तरफ, हमें जो कॉरपोरेट्स हैं उधर ले जाएंगे एक लालच देकर छोटे किसानों को कि आपकी फसल जल्दी बिक जाएगी। कहीं ऐसा तो ना हो जाए हम 60s में चले जाएं सर, 1960 में जब फूड ग्रेन का क्राइसिस आया था, खाने को अनाज नहीं होता था। मेरे ताऊ अक्सर इस बात को डिस्कस करते हैं सर कि हमारे घरों में नॉर्मल किसान का जो घर है एक छोटे किसान का, 1960s में या 60s से पहले 40s 50s में रोटी के लिए अनाज नहीं होता था सर। मेरे ताऊ बताते हैं इस टाइम उनकी एज लगभग 88-89 ईयर्स है, वो कहते हैं गाजर उगाया करते और गाजर खाकर सो जाया करते थे, मतलब उनका अपना एक्सपीरियंस है सर। तो कहीं ना कहीं भी इस तरह के बिल हमें कहीं वहीं ना ले जाएं फिर से सर। ये थोड़ा सा कॉन्ट्रैक्ट फार्मिंग के बारे में थोड़ी सी क्लैरिटी चाहती हूँ आपसे, रिक्वेस्ट।
जी
हाँ जी
ठीक है सर, मुझे लगता है आप इन पे कमेंट करेंगे और फिर उसके बाद हम देखते हैं सर।
ओके, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई एम ग्रेटफुल दैट सम पर्टिनेंट क्वेश्चंस आर पोस्ड बाय वेरी सीनियर पर्संस लाइक रविंद्र कुमार जी गुप्ता। सो आई एम वेरी वेरी हैप्पी टू से फ्यू थिंग्स इन रिस्पॉन्स टू हिज कंसर्न्स। आई थिंक दैट आई शेयर his concerns. I know that the minimum support price, as I've told you, is only applicable in the two crops and a half, but sugarcane is announcing prices and state is largely responsible, and mostly you'll find that the sugarcane mills are having a very different behavior, where large amount of money is expected to be paid, but they are not paying. So next season comes and, you know, previous payments are not being made. So I know there are a lot of difficulties in this kind of contract forming and all that. But the issue which he has raised, that once Central Act is applicable, can state have a power to do so, to repeal those kind of acts? I think that there are two mechanisms. One mechanism which is followed by the Kerala Assembly, they have passed a resolution asking the central government that these laws are not favorable to their state, hence these laws to be repealed. The second very important issue which has been taken by the more activist states like Punjab, then Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh and all that, what they have been doing is that they have passing the alternative laws to, you know, repeal the laws of the central government. But you know that that has a procedure, and the procedure is that the assembly, when passes a resolution, it goes to the governor, and governor has to expected to send to the government of India, and the assent of the president is required. So until this process is not complete, you will find that these laws are null and void. So that means central government's laws are inoperative. So there are mechanisms, but this is the mechanism which has not been worked, I think, that governors have not passed these regulations or laws, which are alternative laws to the central government's, hence no locus standi of the Punjab government's laws and central government laws are applicable. So I think that this is a clarity, but normally the legal luminaries, I have listened to many, retired Supreme Court judges as well as High Court judges. They have been talking about that whatever is the matter, even if in a concurrent list, agriculture items, even in the concurrent list, the central government cannot legislate. And even if the central government try to legislate, you'll find that it is a moral responsibility of the central government not to legislate. So I think that they have been talking about that, you know, the central government, even in the concurrent list, which is going to affect the state without taking into confidence the states, you know, is not morally right, ethically, morally not right, even if legally they are right. So I think that that is historically what they have done, is that if morally and ethical decisions which are not favorable but taken by the central government, most of the laws has been struck by the high courts as well as the Supreme Courts. So therefore, those legal mechanisms are available if the Supreme Court of India and high courts of the country are independently functioning and they are only interpreting the constitution, not, you know, looking at which party did it. So I think that is the impartiality and the kind of responsibility given by the Constitution of India to the Supreme Court of India. I think the Supreme Court and the High Courts of India should, whenever intervene, they should, you know, keep up the responsibility of the Constitution in high esteem. So if that happens, you know, the people accept that kind of judgment. If Supreme Court will deliver a partial or a biased judgment, then the Supreme Court will be also gone. So they will not, people will not allow this to happen. Then you will find that what is happening against government, the people will go against the Supreme Court of India also. So then the judges will not save, the Supreme Court of India and the high courts will not be safe. I think that is the kind of condition which invites civil war. And I do believe that we should settle the issues in a peaceful manner rather than pushing the country and the people into a greater kind of civil war. And I would like to warn all of the people who are listening that these laws have generated a wedge between the business, big business, and the people. So I think this is the most dangerous kind of situation for the developmental purposes. No country in the world can develop where harmonious relationship between the small businesses and the large businesses, as well as those who are the people of the country, they have a high degree of esteem with each other. So I think that this is a dangerous trend which have started with these three laws. And even if there is no other consideration to repeal these laws, this should be the consideration of the government of India, that these laws should be repealed because these are suspiciously generating a suspicion between the general people as well as the big business. Today you will find that people are shifting geo connections. I think this is a kind of dangerous signal, and the Ambani group has filed a case in the High Court of Punjab and Haryana, which again I think is going there, means that dispute has been there, and this dispute is bad if it is spread to all over India. So I think the government of India must take a seriously this step into consideration, that you know, the even if the laws are legal, everything is fine, even then they should repeal the laws, develop a mechanism which is acceptable to the people, and immediately, you know, stop the wedge between the business and the other communities, so that you will find that harmonious relationship for the overall development of the country can be made. So this is one. The second very important aspect, Harvinder has, Dr. Harvinder, you have raised a very important question, and I can share with you your concerns, because I also belong to, long ago, I born and brought up in a farming family. Although I'm, you know, from the last 32, 33 years period of time, a professor in the university, and then, you know, a long time student in the university. So I have not been directly in any way related to the agriculture sector, the economy, but my subject to examine agriculture is alive all the time. So from my own experience and studies which has been examined by me and even conducted by us, these studies have been stating that the contracts are being prepared by the agencies and the farmers are relatively illiterate. You'll find that these contracts are always unfavorable to the farming community or the poor people. I will tell you a simple example. I have published 9 books. 6 or 7 books are from the world's top publishers of India. And then, you know, when I publish a book with them, they have a long agreement form. It takes normally a day to read it and interpret it. So whenever I ask that this clause is not good for the author, so they say, oh, no, we will not change. If you want to publish with someone else, you can do it, but we will not change. So you know that the author who has created ideas, the whole money which is generated out of the sale of that, is they takes away. So I think that the contracts are normally with the monopolies. And if you have a monopolies, those who are very big firms, and the contracts they make in favor to them. I can ask you, you all have insurance with you. Either you have a motorcycle, scooter, or a car. And even when you are in service, you have insurance policy. Can you tell me what benefit you have got out of insurance? The companies which have a long agreement, you might have not read it at all. So then you'll find that those agreements are usually benefiting profits are to the companies, rather those are even public sector companies. Some insurance companies are public sector companies, and now recently large number of private companies are there. Similarly, the agriculture insurance, the amount of benefits which are transmitted are not 1/3 even the benefit, the profit which they have achieved. So I think that this is the contract. The contracts are always being manufactured and produced, which is going to benefit those who are having a good economic strength, and those who have a less power, economic power, they turn out to be unfavorable to them. So these, even in laws, when the laws are being produced, you will find that the favor has been directly or interpretation level is given to the company. It is not the favor is given to the farmer. So I think this is how you'll find that when laws are protecting the companies, the contracts are prepared by the companies, how you can say that even if we have experience of Pepsi and several other companies, when you'll find that there is a glut in the market, they purchase from the market saying that the farmer, your quality is not good. Okay. so then the contract is repealed. So then you'll find that whenever there is a shortage, they say the contract is legally binding. You have to, you know, the prices are higher in the market, and your contract is lower. They say that you are bound by the contract and you have to, you know, sell to us. So I think this is a term which the contract is largely, you know, favorable. Who has the adjudication mechanism, the dispute settlement mechanism has been developed in a manner which is wise and favorable to them. Even civil courts are debarred not to take up these matters at all. So I think this is true in your situation and all that.
Yes, sir. डॉक्टर रमेश कुमार जी भी कुछ कहना चाहते हैं और नीतीश
सर, एक कमेंट था मेरा ऑब्जर्वेशन सिर्फ एक ही है मेरा ऑब्जर्वेशन इस पूरे सिस्टम को लेकर। मुझे ये लगता है कि सर हम महात्मा गांधी जी के लास्ट डिक्टम को भूल गए हैं, जब उन्होंने ये कहा था नेहरू जी को लेटर में कि आप नीतियां बनाते समय आखिरी व्यक्ति का चेहरा देखें। चेहरे पर खुशी आती है तो ठीक है नीति, और नहीं तो उसको आप हटा दीजिए। तो मैं ये कहूँ कि ये जो संवाद की प्रक्रिया है ये भी जारी रहे, क्योंकि डॉक्टर साहब ने कहा था आशुतोष जी ने शुरू में कि भी कोई भी सरकार क्यों चाहेगी कि जहाँ पब्लिक नाराज हो जाए या वेलफेयर स्टेट है। तो मैं ये समझता हूँ कि ये भ्रम की स्थिति को दूर करना बहुत जरूरी है, और जिसके लिए महात्मा गांधी जी के इस डिक्टम को हमें याद रखना होगा, तभी सरकारें लोक कल्याण कर पाएंगी और हमारा सिस्टम बच पाएगा।
राइट,
धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू।
गांधी वाज डंप्ड बाय नेहरू, जब उन्होंने अपनी वो बुक हिंद स्वराज भेजी थी डॉक्टर साहब, अगर आपको याद हो तो नेहरू ने उठा के उसको परे फेंक दिया था कि ये क्या है। तो विलेज इकोनॉमी को तो हमने वैसे ही चलिए जाने दीजिए। हाँ जी रमेश जी।
डॉक्टर साहब थैंक यू वेरी मच।
जी सर।
डॉक्टर साहब थैंक यू फॉर प्रेजेंटेशन, एक्सीलेंट प्रेजेंटेशन। जैसा कि अभी डॉक्टर गुप्ता जी ने कहा, डॉक्टर अरविंदर कौर जी ने कहा, मेरा एक सवाल है आपसे कि व्हाई दैट लॉ इज प्रिवेलिंग बिटवीन द गवर्नमेंट एंड फार्मर्स व्हेन देयर इज अ सो मच कंसाइंस ड्राइवन सॉल्यूशंस मे बी डन, व्हाई सच टाइप ऑफ डेड लॉक इज प्रिवेलिंग बिटवीन द गवर्नमेंट एंड द फार्मर्स व्हेन देयर आर सो मेनी रिप्रेजेंटेटिव इन द गवर्नमेंट इन स्टेट्स एंड गवर्नमेंट। दिस इज माय हंबल सबमिशन।
I think this is a most difficult question which you have posed, because the discussions are going on and there are several rounds, and sometime deadlock occurred and sometime the discussions are proceeding forward. So we cannot conclude immediately that deadlock is there, because farmers and farmers leaders as well as government has declared that they are moving forward. So I think that, but still, your observation is from the empirical side, because the in this severe cold, when large number of farmers, large number of deaths are occurring of the farmers because of cold, and you know, as more deaths are occurring, strong opinions against the government is building. So why government is allowing this long wait to occur? I think that there are, you know, if we understand the difficulties. You know, the laws are favoring a group which is very powerful, and they have a large number of instruments of opinion building with them. Yes. For example, that the business homes, newspaper, business homes, the televisions,
yes.
And they have a lot of financial power to corrupt anybody. So you will find that they have a big pressure that these laws which are going to, you know, benefit to the business community, they do not want the government to backtrack on these laws. Government may want, but you know, the interest groups usually, you know, put pressure on the government, because you know, in today's world, the large amount of policies which are public policies which are being determined, that is satisfying to the business group more than the people in large. So I think that kind of imbalance which has occurred for a long period of time, that allows the stick to the stand, and you'll find that they usually believe that if this laws are going to be repealed, then the government will not have a face. I think that it is rather good for the government if they have to give a good governance and the durability of the governance, sustainability of the governance. They can very easily say that we are going to put these laws on hold, and developing an alternative mechanism of consultancy to larger amount of people or larger stakeholders, and develop an institutional mechanism through which later on those laws will be acceptable, again will be passed. And that will consider that, as I suggested, that the National Agriculture Development Council should be instituted, where you'll find that the national government, state government representative, then the stakeholders representative, consumers representative, experts representative. So all these can be together, and consensus can be built, and that consensus they put in the parliament. I do not think that the people of India will say that we don't want improvements. I think that the people of India, to my understanding, everybody individually, collectively wants that we should improve. We should move ahead. So I think that there is no such kind of conditions that, if these laws are repealed, then there is no face of the government. I think that rather it is going to benefit the government of India at present, or the party in power, if they will put hold on these laws, and then develop a larger mechanism where you'll find that everybody is represented, and then gradually those laws which are acceptable to the people for the improvement of the people can be brought in. So I think that you are very right in stating that this stalemate is going on. It may be some kind of prestigious issue. If, for example, my understanding is that I did a mistake, and I admitted that, government of India has admitted that 14 corrections suggested by the farmers organization during discussion was accepted by the government. And government was saying that only allow us laws, but you can make any change. Why not? If such a bad kind of laws are there, why not repeal it or make it, kept in abeyance and develop an alternative mechanism to develop better laws? So, I think that deadlock, rather than deadlock, the government should say that we have kept these laws in abeyance, set up the alternative mechanism, and we will again only introduce if that mechanism try to build the consensus. So I think that this is possible.
Ji, sir, thank you. Or sir, ek sawal aur mere khayal hai, Nitish Isar, aap kuch kehna chahte hain Nitish ji?
Yes, good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for letting me to speak my views about your thing. Sir, I have a very, very simple question to ask for my seniors. Sir, I have a question that we always hear that this agenda was on depending on farmers, like how the government is manipulating them, but people are making as a religious agenda as well, one thing. And since 2005 until 2020, last 15 years, more than 3500 farmers have committed suicide just before this law. And like how sir have already explained, like this problem is occurring in Haryana, Punjab, and Western UP. Sir, only like I have just studied about it, only 7 to 8% farmers are having problems. So they want to rectify the whole country for it. Is it good for modernization? Like we have to let them to have apply if these things are good. Yeah, we all know that everything has good and bad points, pros and cons. Could you please explain me on this?
You are not audible right now.
I have understood.
I think Dr. Saab has got your question.
Yes, sir. Please
Okay. I think that first of all, you are mistaken by saying 7 to 8% farmers are having a problem with this. All of Indian farmers are in trouble. As you have yourself said that the farmers are committing suicides. I will tell you, in the year 1995, there was a survey conducted in the coastal Andhra, where large number of farmers committed suicides. Then Karnataka, then Kerala, you know, the Maharashtra, and then, you know, Punjab has started in 2000. So I think that various ways, the farming has a huge crisis for a long period of time. Although the organization and some of the immediate issues, which I talked to you, that the price issue, which is applicable only to two states, that's why it's more pinching to them. But in other parts of the world, in other parts of India, the for example, in Kerala, you know that the paddy minimum support price given by the state government is 2800 plus. However, central government gives price 1800, but this is a 1000 more the Kerala government is giving. The farmers over there pressurize the government to pass a resolution that stating that these laws should not be applicable to them. So I think that similarly, you know, the other parts of the country, the farmers are in doing agitation, and they know they are all affected. But you know that the kind of nowadays, if you look at in Delhi organization, 500 farmers organization all over the country, they are participating and spearheading. Although visibility is of Punjab and Haryana is more, that is true. And even from Western Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh, the farmers are wearing turbans, and perhaps some people can connect it to their particular religion. That is not actually true. Farmer is a farmer. I will tell you, the farmers historically changed their religion, but not they have not left the land. So I think that if you have a sense of history for a long period of time, the farmers changed their religion, but they have not, you know, left the land. So I think that you are, anybody who is talking about this religion or that religion are mistaken. The farmers' religion is land. Once they consider that land is going to be confiscated by someone else through various ways and means adopted, the farmers are, that's why they are agitating. So we have to understand that it is not 7-8% farmers, it is the whole of India. Even the consumers are realizing that if these laws are going to be applicable, you will find that fluctuation in food prices are going to occur, and that will be, you know, and we have seen before Diwali, you have seen that the onion prices was rising a lot, then government immediately after passing these laws, you know, limited the stocks again. So, you know, the government has to intervene. So I think that that is the enough signal to the government that, you know, this is going to happen very frequently. So they can very easily say that we have already experimented, and we are, you know, keeping these laws at abeyance, and, you know, new laws need to be proposed with the consultation of a wider participation of the people, institutional mechanism. That will help us build a better India, more progressive India, and more progressive party which is in power, rather than, you know, taking it as a kind of prestigious thing.
Rather, ऐसा लगा है सर, यहाँ तो ऐसा कुछ लगा है इस agitation में कि religion से उठकर सब, तो religion से उठ
ही नहीं सर. For a farmer, land is the religion.
Yes, sir.
And they can change the religion. If you know they want to keep land, they can leave the religion.
चलिए ठीक है सर,
thank you, बहुत थैंक यू.
हाँ चलिए ठीक है नितिन जी, नीतीश जी आपकी भी बात सुनी गई और उसका उत्तर भी दिया जो संभव था. हालांकि बहुत सारे ऐसे छोटे छोटे ऑफ शूट्स होते हैं जो बड़े डिस्टर्बिंग होते हैं, और वो भी एक कारण रहता है बीच में जब इस तरह की हम चर्चाएं ऑर्गेनाइज करते हैं. लेकिन ये एकेडमिक चर्चा है, हम फॉर एंड अगेंस्ट वाला यहाँ मामला ज़्यादा नहीं है. अपनी समझ के लिए हमने ये चर्चा आयोजित की है. ताकि बेहतर तरीके से हम रिस्पॉन्ड कर सकें सिचुएशंस को, अपने स्टूडेंट्स को भी समझा सकें और अपने साथियों के साथ बात करने के लिए हम उस स्तर पे आ सकें, अन्यथा वो सिर्फ एक झगड़ा सा बना रहता है, विवाद सा बना रहता है, वो कम से कम मेरे लिए तो वो नहीं है। तो मैं इन शब्दों के साथ धन्यवाद करता हूँ डॉक्टर साहब का, और जितने लोग अब बचे रह गए हैं हमारे साथ जुड़े हुए अंत तक धन्यवाद करता हूँ। लेकिन औपचारिक रूप से धन्यवाद करने के लिए मैं डॉक्टर हरविंदर कौर जी को निवेदन करता हूँ, जो हेड हैं डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स एसटी कॉलेज में। तो उनसे मैं निवेदन करता हूँ कि वो धन्यवाद ज्ञापन करें डॉक्टर साहब का भी और बाकी सब श्रोताओं का भी।
धन्यवाद सर, आपने मुझे यह अपॉर्चुनिटी दी कि मैं इतने जीनियस अपने जो स्पीकर हैं आज के, उनका मैं धन्यवाद कर पाऊँ। हालांकि शब्द नहीं होते धन्यवाद के लिए, इतनी इन्फॉर्मेशन हमें मिली है सर ने, हमें बहुत ही इन्फॉर्मेशन दी। सर ने बताया कि इंडिया जहां पर 86% फार्मर्स जो है वो मार्जिनल फार्मर है, वो स्मॉल फार्मर है, जिसके पास सरप्लस बेचने को नहीं होता, उसको ट्रेड एंड कॉमर्स एक्ट का क्या फायदा पहुंचेगा? उसके पास इतना कुछ ट्रांसपोर्टेशन की सुविधा नहीं होती कि वो दूसरे स्टेट में अपने प्रोडक्ट को ले जाए, तो उसके लिए कहीं ना कहीं ऐसा लगता है कि इस पहले बिल का कोई रेलिवेंस नहीं रह जाता। उसके बाद छोटी सी फार्मिंग है, वो अपने सोशल में समाज में मिलकर करता है, वहीं से उधार लेता है, वहीं से वो खाद बीज खरीद कर अपना जीवन यापन करता है। कहीं ना कहीं मुझे भी ऐसा लगता है, मैं सर की बात से सहमत हूँ कि सरकार कहीं डाइवर्ट हो चुकी है शायद, क्योंकि जो सरकार का टारगेट था 2022 तक फार्मर्स की इनकम को डबल करने का, वहां से डाइवर्ट होकर सरकार शायद आई तो किसी अच्छे पर्पज से थी इन थ्री बिल्स को लेकर, बट गहन स्टडी नहीं हुई। उसके बाद यहाँ कहीं संदेह भी रहा पब्लिक के बीच में भी, किसानों के बीच में भी, और संदेह का कारण जैसा कि डॉक्टर साहब ने बताया कि जब 5 जून को ये बिल लेकर आए गए, जब सीवियर लॉकडाउन था और एग्रीकल्चर एक लाइफलाइन प्रूव हो रही थी इंडियन इकोनॉमी के लिए, सिंगल ऐसा एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर ऐसा सेक्टर रहा जिसकी ग्रोथ रेट 3.4% रही, तो कोई ऐसा क्रॉनिक स्टेट नहीं थी एग्रीकल्चर की कि इन बिल्स को लेकर आया जाए। कहीं ना कहीं प्री प्लानिंग चली हुई थी, तो ऐसे समय को चुना गया ताकि एक भीड़ ना जुट पाए। बट फिर भी मैं तो ये कहना चाहूंगी सर के अकॉर्डिंग ही कि हरियाणा और पंजाब का जो किसान है जागरूक है, एजुकेटेड है, वो मूर्ख नहीं है। सरकार ज्यादा चतुर हो सकती है बट किसान भी अब इतना मूर्ख नहीं है। सरकार की जो ये पॉलिसी है ना कि नाम को लूट लू और शाम को पे कर दो, देखो ये पॉलिसी कम से कम फार्मर्स के साथ तो ना हो, उनकी कब्रों के ऊपर कोई राजनीति ना हो। तो मैं सर का बहुत ही धन्यवाद करना चाहूंगी और अगली बार फिर से सर से एक प्रॉमिस लेते हैं कि इन्हीं वैल्यूएबल विषय पर फिर से सर ये जरूर हम टॉक चाहेंगे, संभव हुआ तो ये COVID-19 के बाद हम आमने सामने बैठकर जो बात करेंगे वो ज्यादा अच्छा रहेगा सर।
आई एम ऑलवेज अवेलेबल टू यू।
जी सर, ये तो मैं विश्वास करता ही हूँ और मैं अपना अधिकार भी समझता हूँ कि आपसे
मुझे लग रहा है कि आपके साथ मेरे इतने संबंध जो बन गए हैं, मैं तो आपको फैमिली का पार्ट समझता हूँ। तो आपका आमंत्रण आए और मैं उसको नहीं स्वीकार करूँ ये नहीं हो सकता।
जी थैंक यू सो मच सर।
थैंक यू सो मच।
आई एम ऑनर्ड सर। ऑनर्ड। तो इन्हीं सब शब्दों के साथ आप सभी लोगों का धन्यवाद, डॉक्टर साहब जी का धन्यवाद कि उन्होंने बहुत सारे पक्ष जो हमें नहीं स्पष्ट थे, और बातचीत करने का जो लहजा होना चाहिए, जो तरीका और सेंस होनी चाहिए, वो निश्चित रूप से हमारी एनरिच हुई है और हम आगे से बेहतर इन टेक्निकल इश्यूज को समझ पाए हैं। और निश्चित ही मैं आगे जो और चर्चाएं लूंगा, निश्चित रूप से उनमें ये इकोनॉमिक्स को समझने का जो तरीका है या उसको रिकंस्ट्रक्ट या डीकंस्ट्रक्ट करना दोनों शब्दों के प्रयोग के साथ, उसको भी हम फ्यूचर में टेकअप करेंगे, क्योंकि ये दिशा को बहुत सही नहीं है जो इकोनॉमिक्स की चल रही है और उसमें इतना कॉम्प्लिकेटेड होता जा रहा है और वो हम सभी के ऊपर एक अनडिजायरेबल प्रेशर बना रही है। तो इकोनॉमिक्स जो है वो मनुष्य के लिए है, ना कि मनुष्य इकोनॉमिक्स के लिए है। इस बात को ध्यान में रखते हुए निश्चित रूप से हम दोबारा बातचीत करने के लिए उपस्थित होंगे और डॉक्टर साहब उसमें हमें सहयोग करेंगे, दिशा निर्देश भी देंगे, और फिर हम दोबारा मिलेंगे जल्दी ही। और इन्हीं सब शब्दों के साथ आप सबका बहुत बहुत आभार, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, थैंक यू सो मच आप सब लोगों के कहने के लिए भी और सुनने के लिए, थैंक यू सर।
नमस्ते सर।
हाँ जी रोहतास जी धन्यवाद सर।
नमस्ते सर। नमस्ते सर।
ठीक है सर, आप सभी लोग मीटिंग छोड़ सकते हैं, यदि किसी ने कुछ कहना हो तो वो मुझे अलग से बता सकते हैं।